Good morning, everyone. This is Darmadi Komo from SQL Server Marketing. We're very happy today that we have a good sessions for you. The topic we're going to talk about today is SQL Server in Windows Azure Virtual Machine. And we're going to go through the agenda for today quickly to show you what we have planned for you. The very first one we'll start jumping in is SQL Server in Virtual Windows Azure Virtual Machine Overview. Louis is going to help me doing that. And then we'll jump into the second session, which is SQL Server on Windows Azure Virtual Machine Performance Tuning, and follow with the Data Warehouse in SQL Server Windows Azure Virtual Machine, and finally, Business Intelligence as well, right? So we'll have a good set of agenda for you, and we're very excited to share this with you. So with me today, I have Luis from engineering. Luis, can you tell us who you are and what are you going to talk about today?
Absolutely. Thank you, first, for having me here. So my name is Luis Vargas. I'm a program manager lead on the Windows Azure VM support for SQL Server. So basically, our team handles running SQL Server on the Windows Azure infrastructure and making sure that Windows Azure is the best platform for running SQL Server. So we work on that. We also work on what we call hybrid scenarios, which is offering cloud services to our on-premise customers, so people who are running SQL Server on-premise in their own corporate environments, offering support for from the Windows Azure perspective. So today we're going to be talking about four topics as part of the talk. First, we're going to introduce what we call the SQL Server Cloud Continuum, and that is basically the path between on-premise and the cloud, right, and the different iterations between them. Then we're going to go and talk about Windows Azure Virtual Machines. So we're going to look at what is the offering that we have for virtual machines. And then we're going to look specifically at SQL Server running in Windows Azure Virtual Machines. And finally, we have some best practices associated with that. So we'll talk about all those things.
Okay. Well, I understand that SQL Server runs in all kinds of places, in on-prem, in the cloud, and all that. And you have a good way of describing it. Can you tell us in more detail?
Sure. So let's talk about the SQL Server Cloud Continuum. So in this graphic, basically, you can see all the different iterations that we have today and how many how customers are utilizing SQL Server, right? So SQL Server today is the most database used in the planet. And we have different ways of how people are using it. So on the left bottom side, you see physical. So many people are still running SQL Server on physical machines using the machines themselves. And that has been, you know, traditionally how people have been running them. Over the past few years, we have seen many more people virtualizing SQL Server. So people using Hyper-V, for example, right, where you can have a large number of SQL Server instances running in virtual machines as part of the same physical host. And people are doing that in order to reduce costs. So the more that you share the underlying infrastructure, the less cost that you have, because you're amortizing the cost across a large number of SQL servers and a large across a large number of databases. So that's why we see more people using that. In the at the bottom, you can see on the left side, you have high control, high maintenance, right? So if you, for example, run your SQL Server in physical machines, you probably have a large number of physical machines that you have to manage, right? And because of that, there is a cost associated with that. Okay. Whereas in the case of virtualizing, you reduce the number of physical machines, right? And that's how you amortize the cost. Now, in the middle, we have SQL Server in Windows Azure Virtual Machines, or, you know, as in the industry, it's known, infrastructure as a service. And this is what we're going to be talking about today. And this basically means running your SQL servers in Windows Azure Virtual Machines. These are virtual machines that are hosted by the Windows Azure infrastructure, right? So in this case, the main difference is that the host machines, the actual physical hardware, is managed by Windows Azure. And that means that you don't have to manage it, right? You don't need to go and buy new hardware. For example, if you have some applications that you need to host, you can simply host them in these virtual machines, right? And Windows Azure is going to take care of them. And we'll talk about in more detail what exactly Windows Azure provides as part of the offering. Then after that, you move one more step into what we call platform as a service. And here the difference is that from the platform, instead of having access to a virtual machine, you have access to a database. So the level of abstraction changes from the virtual machine into a single database. And the difference here is that because we're virtualizing the databases, right? And the actual official name for this is Windows Azure SQL Database. In this case, we virtualize the database. We take care of many of the maintenance operations associated with that database. But at the same time, the level of control that you have is lower because basically you have access to the database, but you don't have access to underlying maintenance operations. So we'll talk a little bit more about that in detail. And finally, you know, on the top, we have software as a service, and this is when you can access an application directly, offer it as a service in Windows Azure. And so examples of this are, for example, Office 365, where you can access directly the Office application, right? And you don't have to think about how the data is stored. So you don't really have the concept of database at that point. Okay. Right? So this is basically the continuum, and this is how we see customers using the SQL Server across the different platforms.
So we're going to focus on the one that is in the center, right?
Yep.
The IIS SQL Server and Virtual Machine. Mm-hmm. You're going to describe to us in more details, right?
Right, absolutely. Okay. Mm-hmm. So it's going to talk about Windows Azure Virtual Machines first, mm-hmm. and then we'll talk about SQL Server running in Windows Azure. So what exactly Windows Azure Virtual Machine means? All this means virtual machines that are hosted on the Windows Azure infrastructure. We offer multiple virtual machine images that you can use to provision virtual machines, and I'll show you that in a demo. We have images, for example, for SQL Server, for Windows Server, etc., and you can provision virtual machines out of those. You can bring your own images, so you can, for example, take a BHD of one virtual machine, and then you can upload that BHD to Windows Azure, and you can provision multiple virtual machines out of that BHD. Mm-hmm. Provisioning is really fast. It's 10 minutes right now, and that's from the time that you start the process to the time that you have a virtual machine running with SQL Server.
Okay.
Your virtual machines are accessible in different ways. You can access them to remote desktop, for example, just as traditionally you use any SQL Server in your own environment. You can use PowerShell, for example, as well. All the information for your virtual machines is accessible through the portal. We'll look at that. And also you have some REST API. So for people who are using REST, for example, they can use that to gather information about their virtual machines as well. We offer paper per usage. So basically, you only pay for the time that you use the virtual machine. So and we do this at the minute, by the minute. So we don't round up. Basically, you only pay for every minute that you use the virtual machine. The moment that you don't need the virtual machine, you can stop it, for example.
Okay.
Right? And if the virtual machine is not running, you're not going to pay for that.
Okay.
Right? The cost of the virtual machine depends on a couple of factors. It depends on the size of the virtual machine. So we have different sizes that go from what we call extra small, which is one core, for example, and having 1 gigabyte of RAM to, we have very different sizes, right? And it can go all the way to 8 cores, for example, and 56 gigabytes of RAM. So depending on the size of the virtual machine, you pay some price per minute. And also there is some cost associated with licensing. So for example, if you use a virtual machine from an image that has SQL Server,
right,
there'll be some cost associated per minute with that, right? And again, we have different versions of SQL, like Enterprise or Standard or Web Edition, and the cost will depend on that.
So when I turn it off, for example, I will not get billed for the usage, since I'm not using it, so I turn it off. But I'm still paying for the storage.
Correct,
of course, right?
Correct. So you stop the machine. We still keep the storage accessible for you. So in the case that you want to restart the virtual machine,
right,
you don't have to go and recreate it again.
Mm-hmm.
So you will only pay for that storage, which is a very, very small amount.
Okay.
Something else to mention for people who have MSDN subscriptions, we have large discounts. So if you go into the Windows Azure portal site, you will find more about it.
Mm-hmm.
But again, very, very interesting offering. In terms of network, you don't pay for data that you send into Windows Azure. So if you're uploading, for example, a large multi-terabyte database into mm-hmm. Windows Azure, you're not paying for that.
Okay.
You only pay for the outgoing cost.
Right? I see.
So that's how it works. As we mentioned, storage, you only pay for what you use, not what you allocate.
Mm-hmm.
So for example, if you have one virtual machine and you allocate, let's say, 5 terabytes of data, and you're only using 1 terabyte, you only pay for that terabyte. You don't pay for the other four.
Okay.
So you can start over-provisioning, you know, thinking about the future, and you only pay for what you use. Elasticity, a very powerful concept. It's very easy to go and change the size of your virtual machine. You can do this through the portal, for example, and it takes a couple of minutes. And you can go from, again, a very small virtual machine to a very large virtual machine, right? So from 1 core and 2 gigabytes of RAM to 8 cores and 56 gigabytes of RAM. We're always introducing new sizes. So, you know, as time progresses, you'll see more RAM and more cores available. Finally, again, you have high level of control, similar to how you do it on-premise. But at the same time, that means that you have some responsibilities in that virtual machine. So in the same way as you today manage your virtual machines on-premise, you will manage them in Windows Azure. And that means you're in charge of security, for example, who can access that virtual machine, those Windows accounts, for example. You're in charge of patching the operating system in that virtual machine and monitoring as well. Right? So I think it's important before talking about SQL Server, how is the storage managed in Windows Azure. So every disk that these virtual machines have attached ends in what we call Azure Storage. And Azure Storage is basically a cluster dedicated to store all the data for Windows Azure, right? So you have thousands of disks that we can use as basically share storage across all of these virtual machines. Azure Storage provides high availability for all the data. And this is based on 3 synchronous local copies. So what this means is for every disk, Windows Azure Storage will maintain 3 copies, right? Okay. And these are synchronous. What this means is for some reason, one of these copies fails because, for example, there is a corruption in one of these disks. We can automatically redirect those reads and writes to another copy of the disk, right? And all of this is transparent to the virtual machine. Right? So it's very highly available from the client perspective. We also have the option of 3 more asynchronous copies in a different data center. And this is if you turn on an option called geo-replication. And what geo-replication does is we asynchronously copy that disk to 3 more copies in a different data center. And again, this is for disaster recovery purposes.
Okay.
So in worst case scenario where a full Windows Azure data center becomes unavailable for some reason, we can go and recreate all those virtual machines in a different data center and continue running.
So by default, 3 sync local copies are there.
Right.
But the remote copies is optional.
It's optional. You specify it in the portal.
Okay.
All right, in terms of availability, so the first SLA is you'll never lose data. So Windows Azure guarantees, again, through these 3 copies, that data will always be available. That's super important for SQL Server. If the virtual machine becomes unavailable, right, because, for example, the host machine fails or because there is some network problem, Windows Azure will automatically restart the virtual machine in a different host.
Okay.
It will move the virtual machine. And the way this works is we have all this storage in Windows Azure Storage, right? So if the virtual machine fails, we can just attach that storage right, as disks to a different virtual machine and continue running.
Okay.
So again, it's a transparent process from the customer perspective. We have an SLA today. And the SLA is based on having multiple virtual machines in what is called an availability set. So the availability set is a concept, and I'll show you this in the demo. It's a concept in Windows Azure where if you put 2 or more virtual machines in the availability set, you're telling Windows Azure to locate those virtual machines in different hosts and in different racks. And the idea is that if for some reason there is a failure even at the rack level, right? For example, the rack loses connectivity, you'll still have 1 or more virtual machines in different racks that are available, right? So the SLA is 99.95%, and that means that you're going to have less than 22 minutes of downtime per month. Right? That means that at most 22 minutes, you're not going to have neither of these virtual machines accessible. Right? And we'll talk about with SQL Server specifically if you require even higher levels of availability. Right? If you're looking, for example, at 2 nines or even more than that, how can you achieve that with SQL Server? In terms of this availability, this SLA, it includes a couple of things. It includes planned downtime. So every month, Windows Azure refreshes the host, right? So all of those virtual machines are running in some host machines, and we refresh the operating system. We make sure that it has every security update, for example. And also unplanned downtime due to physical failures. So again, virtual machines may be impacted, for example, because a host fails. So all of that is covered by this SLA, right? It doesn't include the servicing of the guest OS. So similarly to on-premise, you still need to patch Windows, for example, in those virtual machines.
Okay.
Windows Azure, again, provides support for disaster recovery. So worst case scenario, if Windows Azure becomes unavailable, we have a different data center where we can restart these machines. The maximum estimated data loss that we have right now is 30 minutes. Again, this is in case of a disaster. So far, we haven't had one of them. And then virtual machines will be online in less than 24 hours.
Right.
So all information about availability. Let's talk a little bit more about high availability. Again, important from the SQL Server perspective and how this works in general for Windows Azure. So what you have in the screen is a rack. Right? This is one of the racks that we have in Windows Azure. You have different physical machines. Okay. Right? Each of these physical machines has virtual machines. Right? How many depends on the sizes of the virtual machines. And then in the middle, you see that it has what we call the top of rack,
okay,
which is basically the connection from that rack to the rest of the world. Right? So all the connectivity goes there. All the power goes there. And then it distributes to the different machines. And then we have many of these in a data center,
right,
in Windows Azure. Mm-hmm. Right? Now we have this concept of availability set. So if you put your virtual machines in an availability set, what will happen is that these virtual machines will end up in different racks. Right?
Physical racks.
Physical racks.
OK.
So the way you can achieve high availability is by locating a load balancer between your clients and your virtual machines. Right? So if you put a load balancer, and the way you do this is that you put these virtual machines in what is called a load balance set. Again, it's a concept in the portal. We'll look into that. And by putting this load balancer, all the requests are going to be load balanced between the different virtual machines, right? In case that one of these racks becomes unavailable, right, you will still have the other virtual machines to continue running. Mm. Right? So that's how you can ensure transparent availability for your clients.
Okay. Right? Awesome.
All right, let's talk a little bit about connectivity. So once you have these virtual machines running in Windows Azure, how can you connect to them? So we have two ways. The first one is you can connect to them over the internet, just using public endpoints. Again, the concept of endpoint is similar to the concept of, similar to the concept of ports, for example, in machines, where you open the port and you can connect to that.
Okay.
So in the same way, in Windows Azure, you can create these endpoints. Basically, the endpoints will allow connections on that specific port, right? So if you have clients in your data center, for example, that's one way you can connect to them. Another way to connect to these virtual machines is using a site-to-site tunnel, right? And this site-to-site tunnel is basically a VPN tunnel, right? That allows you to extend your on-premise network into Windows Azure. So this tunnel will allow you to connect to all of those virtual machines in Windows Azure just as if they were part of your local domain.
Okay.
Right? So you can, for example, use your DNS server, and you can refer to those virtual machines in Windows Azure through name, and you can connect to them. The site-to-site tunnel will also allow you to join those virtual machines in Azure to your on-premise domain. It will allow you, for example, to extend all of those domain policies that you have, for example, how often passwords need to change into Windows Azure as well.
Okay.
A site-to-site tunnel is secure as well. So if you want to have, for example, an encrypted channel between on-premise and the cloud, you can use the tunnel for that as well.
Okay.
And there are different ways of how you can create a tunnel. You can configure a physical VPN device. So people who have a Cisco VPN device, for example, they can go and configure that. And I'll show you again that in the demo soon. Another way of doing this is through Windows Server RAS, Routing and Remote Access Services.
Mm-hmm.
So with RAS, you can use software, for example, and then you can set up your tunnel using one of your machines in your corporate environment.
I see. So hardware or software solution?
Hardware or software solution, you can use any, and as you can establish the site-to-site tunnel. Just showing some of the options, how customers can go and enable the site-to-site tunnel today. We have different brands available for physical devices. We talk about Windows Server RAS. We support even generic VPN devices, right? Okay. Even if they're not in this list. There are some of the conditions that they need to fulfill, so they need to be able to basically satisfy some of these algorithms for encryption and authentication, right? Like AES 128, for example, or SHA-1.
Okay, right. Awesome. Well, this is very interesting. Can I see the portal and see how you configure?
Sure. Mm-hmm. So let's look into the portal. Let's have a quick tour. So what I have here is the Windows Azure management portal. So let me make sure that people can see the address there. Manage.windowsazure.com. That's where you go to Windows Azure. So just a quick tour. Basically, on the left side, we have all the different services that are offered by Windows Azure. Right? So you can create websites, for example. We'll have virtual machines, and this is where we're going to be spending most of the time today. But there are other things that you can do. Mobile services, for example. SQL database, again, this is the PaaS offering, right? Platform as a service, where you get access to your SQL database. Information about storage. So you can create what is called storage accounts, mm-hmm. and you can store what is called blobs, binary large objects. So this is basically where you can store all the disks associated with your virtual machines. Right? And then we have many other things. I will spend a little bit more time talking about networks. Right? Networks is an important concept, and this is how you can enable, for example, the site-to-site tunnel. So we'll look into that as well. And other things like Active Directory, for example, for people who are using Active Directory today. So right now, what you can see in the screen is all the set of virtual machines that I have. You can see the name, the status. You can see most of them are running. I stopped one because I wasn't using it. I didn't want to pay for that one, so I stopped it.
Okay.
You can see the subscription. So as part of one account, right, you can have multiple subscriptions. And this is how you can assign, for example, management operations to different people, right? So with a single account, you can create three, four more subscriptions, and then different IT administrators, for example, can have access to different subscriptions, and each of the subscriptions will have access to different number of virtual machines, for example.
Right.
The location, again, the location is where in the world these virtual machines are located. We have data centers in central US, we have some in Europe, for example, we have some in Asia, and we'll look into that. And finally, the DNS name. And the DNS name is the name that people can use over the internet to connect to these virtual machines.
Okay.
Right? Again, you can specify you want to allow this by creating the endpoints, or you can close the endpoints, and then you can only access this through the tunnel.
Right.
Now, let's go and see how can we go and create a new virtual machine. So I go into New, right? Click New, and then you see, again, all the services. I go into Compute, right? Virtual machine. I can go into Quick Create, which basically just presents me a quick page here, and I can just fill a couple of values and then create the virtual machine. But let's make it a little bit more descriptive, go through the gallery,
okay.
See how it works. So if I click on the gallery, you'll see all the images that we have available for customers, right? So if you click into Microsoft, you'll see all the images that Microsoft has available, right? So you'll see, for example, we have some images for Windows, right? You have SharePoint, for example, and then we have SQL Server, right? In the case of SQL Server, let's look at all the images that we have. So we have, for example, SQL Server 2014 CTP2 already, right?
Okay.
So something interesting, the same day when we release CTP2, we already had the image available, and that's something that we'll continue doing, right? So the moment that we release the RTM version of SQL 2014, in the same day, it will be available here, right?
Okay.
And people will be able to use it.
So they don't need to actually painfully download and install it themselves.
Exactly.
They can actually do it in here.
Exactly. They can go directly to the image gallery and in 10 minutes download the virtual machine and provision the virtual machine and start using it without having to download. Right? Mm-hmm. Something that you'll notice is we have different versions of Windows. So we know that some customers want to use still Windows 2012 mm-hmm. Because they don't want to change, for example, the operating system, so we still have it. But we also have 2012 R2, right, for people who want to use the latest versions. We have, you'll notice that we have something called data warehousing, right? So for both 2014 and 2012, we have this edition called data warehousing. And it's basically an image that has been optimized for data warehousing. Mm-hmm. So we have set up many of the default settings by default optimized for data warehousing. Again, so things like amount of memory assigned to SQL Server, number of disks, the configuration of the disk, all of that thing has been already optimized for data warehousing. Again, we have 2012 SP1, and we even go all the way to 2008 R2, right? So people who today have applications, for example, running in 2008 R2, and they want to decommission some of these machines, or they just need a larger virtual machine, for example, because they have more customers now, they can go and utilize one of these images.
Okay, right?
Awesome. So let's go and provision one of these. So I'm going to use SQL 2014 CTP2. Right? So I click Next here. It'll tell me what version I want to use. I'll just use the latest version, right? Some customers want to maintain a previous version because they want to ensure that they have all the versions running in the same.
Okay.
But in this case, I'm going to use the last one. I'm going to give some name here. So, Albargas virtual machine, and then some name. I can choose the size of the virtual machine. Again, this goes from extra small, mm-hmm. right? Where you have basically one core, which may or may not be shared with other extra small virtual machines, to A7, where you have 8 cores. And again, the amount of RAM changes between the machines. So for now, let me use a medium, for example, 2 cores, 3.5 gigabytes. This is small for now. I give it a name to my administrator. Okay. Right? So I'm going to say L. Vargas is my administrator. I specify a password. All right. And then click Next. Now, cloud service. So the cloud service, you can have a description just hovering there. It's a container for one or more virtual machines. So imagine this as a container for your two-tier or three-tier application, or a container for your set of virtual machines. So you can host all of these virtual machines in the same cloud service, and then some of the management operations will apply to all of them. So it's easier
to... So it's a logical grouping.
It's like a logical grouping mechanism.
Yeah. Okay. Right?
This is the DNS name that I'll use to connect over the cloud. You see the suffix is cloudapp.net.
Okay.
Right? Again, what subscription I want to use for this one. So I'm going to use this one, the manual subscription. And I have some other subscriptions, so just use this one. Where do I want to locate it? So you can see I have different regions, right? Mm-hmm. I have some in Central US, East US, West Europe. At the subscription level, you can specify the regions that will be accessible. So for example, right now, the administrator of my subscription, I think didn't give me the option of West US, but that's another data center that we have accessible. So let's say I want to locate it in Central US. Storage account, again, you may already have some storage accounts that you use to manage all the storage, right? All the disks, for example. If I don't have one or I just want a new one, I just say, create a new one, right? Availability set, we talked about this concept before. I'll show it in the next demo. Again, this is ensuring that these virtual machines are going to be in different racks. In this case, this is only my first virtual machine, so this doesn't apply. So I click Next. Now I can specify what endpoints I'm going to make accessible for my virtual machine. By default, I have remote desktop, right? So I can remote desktop to my machine. I have PowerShell as well, so I can use remote PowerShell, for example, if I want to. I can go and add one more. So I can say I want to use a SQL Server endpoint. And what this is going to do is create an endpoint allowing connections on port 1433, which is the default SQL connection port. Right? So at this point, I can go and say complete, right? And then this is going to go and run for some time, right? Again, this is around 10 minutes. So I'm going to let this run. It's going to run for a while. In the meantime, let me go and show you something about networks.
Okay.
So let's click into networks. If I click in networks, I'm going to see all the networks that I have associated with my subscription. So you'll see, for example, some of these networks, where do I have it here? So yeah, some of these networks are to central US, some of them are to west US, etc. The interesting thing here is if I click on one of these, for example, this one, you'll see that this is a network in the cloud only, right? Mm-hmm. You see, this is basically specifying the name of the network. I can see the virtual machines that I have as part of that network. You can create subnets, right? So in this case, I have, for example, a domain controller running in this subnet, and then I have the rest of the machines running in a different subnet. Now, the interesting thing is I can create these side-to-side tunnels that I told before. Mm-hmm. So in this case, this network is one of those, and I can see that because I have this graphic representation where on one hand, I have Windows Azure, right? And I have the Windows Azure gateway, and on the other hand, I have my on-premise environment, right? And these are connected through the VPN. So the interesting thing here is that through this virtual network, I can refer to all of these virtual machines as well as my on-premise machines using my on-premise DNS servers. And the network gives information about how much data goes inside of Windows Azure, how much data goes outside, information about the IP address that my on-premise environment uses to connect to. And then I can look at all the virtual machines that are part of this virtual network, right? Mm-hmm. And again, I can refer to all of these virtual machines using the name that I give to the virtual machine, even from my on-premise environment. Mm-hmm. Right? So very powerful capability for my domain environment. So let's move on into the next rest of the slide.
Yeah, let's talk about more detail for SQL Server that's running inside these virtual machines.
All right. So let's jump into SQL Server. Mm-hmm. So as we talk about, we have many SQL versions supported. We talk about SQL 2014, 2012, R2. Again, many versions of Windows supported. One of the very, very powerful capabilities is we have almost 100% compatibility with on-premise. The only reason why I say it almost is because we don't support yet SQL clusters. Mm-hmm. That is something that is coming later. But the rest of the application surface is supported. One, the consideration, as we described before, this is in a virtual machine, so mm-hmm. you're in charge of managing security for SQL Server, mm-hmm. backups, high availability, etc.
Right.
Right. What are the scenarios that customers are using for SQL Server in Windows Azure? Mm-hmm. We have three scenarios. The first one is dev and test. So mm-hmm. many people want to build and test new applications, right? And they want to use the latest versions of SQL Server. So they can very easily go, and in 10 minutes, you have the latest version of SQL running, and you
right.
can okay. develop a new application. You can test it. Mm-hmm. Lift and shift. So customers want to move an existing application to Azure. So they can do this without any changes, mm-hmm. right? They can simply move the database to SQL, SQL Server in Windows Azure and continue running. Again, we support multiple versions of SQL and Windows, so whatever version you are using on-premise, you can go and use it there. Whenever you need it, so some customers, for example, have some periods when they need higher processing power, for example, or larger amounts of memory, so during those periods, they can move it, for example, to Windows Azure and run the application there.
Got it.
And then, again, this is an elastic offering, so you can start, for example, with a small or extra small machine, and then once you complete the application and you decide to go into production, you can move into a large or an extra large machine, for example.
Okay.
You have the flexibility, and again, it's very easy to change in the portal. Mm-hmm. And finally, we have some customers that are actually using hybrid scenarios. And in these cases, part of the application is still on-premise. So, for example, they have the application, like the clients, running on-premise, connecting through A.NET, for example, mm-hmm. and they have SQL Server running in the cloud,
okay.
right? And they connect them through the side-to-side tunnel. So that's an example. You can have Active Directory, for example, on-premise, mm-hmm. and you can use Windows authentication to authenticate to those SQL Servers running in Windows Azure. Another scenario that we see people using are having SQL Servers running on-premise, and then adding replicas of SQL Server in Windows Azure virtual machines. And they use this, for example, for disaster recovery, mm-hmm. where if the main data center goes down, they still have one or more copies of those SQL Servers running in Windows Azure mm-hmm. that they can use. The other thing is they can use those SQL Server replicas, for example, to move some of those reporting workloads or backups into Windows Azure, right? Mm-hmm. So people, for example, that need to maintain backups outside of the main data center, they could put a replica in Windows Azure and take the backups there. How do you go and deploy these virtual machines with SQL Server? Well, there are two ways. as we talk about, you can use the gallery image, right? Mm-hmm. And this comes with some predefined options, for example, for memory settings. This image is going to include the engine, the SQL Server engine, integration services, reporting services, analysis services, and management studio, right? So you can use all of these services and utilities. We refresh the image every month. So every CU, every critical hotfix, for example, is already included as part of the CUs, right? At the point of provisioning. And the other option, you can bring your own image, right? So customers are familiar with the concept of software assurance. So if you have your licenses on-premise, you can use what is called license mobility.
Right.
And then you can use those licenses in Windows Azure as well.
Okay.
And the way it works is you prepare your BHD, right, from your on-premise virtual machines. And then you can upload that BHD into Windows Azure. And then you can provision virtual machines from them.
Okay. Right?
Another option that we have in SQL Server 2014 is the deployment wizard. This is a wizard that we introduced in Management Studio. And you can use this to very easily move a database from on-premise into Windows Azure. So the way this works is the wizard takes a backup of your database to a network share, and then we copy this backup to Windows Azure storage, and then we provision a new virtual machine, or you can select an existing virtual machine, and we restore the backup in that virtual machine.
Oh, okay.
So, and the wizard will basically, in case that there is some network connectivity, because you lose connectivity to Azure, and you're trying to move a large database, for example, it will go and retry, so you don't have to start from the beginning. So, something very important, this wizard can be used with previous versions. So, if you download, for example, Management Studio for SQL 2014, you can use this wizard with previous versions of SQL Server, okay. 2012, 2008, or 2, etc.
Wow, this is very interesting. Are you going to show us how it works?
Yes, so I'm going to show you. Well, we're running a little bit out of time, so what I'm going to show you is actually a deployment that I have running with multiple SQL servers in Windows Azure already. Mm-hmm. I have an application. So let me show you. That's probably more interesting for people to see once they have everything running there. So let me go again into my virtual machines here, right? So what I'm going to do is just search for the ones that I'm going to be using in the demo. So if I choose Contoso, basically this is going to show me these SQL servers that I'm going to be using. So right now I'm going to be using this tree, right? So the interesting thing here is you see I have something called Contoso Quorum. Mm-hmm. So what I have here is a SQL Server configuration that has two replicas. Mm-hmm. Right? This is using Always On.
Okay.
Right? This is a high availability solution for SQL Server. And I have a primary and a secondary. I have a witness. Again, this is for automatic failover. But what I wanted to show is if I click on one of these, so let me click here. You'll get more information about your virtual machine. Right? So you'll get, for example, information about the CPU utilization, disk utilization for reads and writes, network, etc. This virtual machine is a large virtual machine. You can see here it has 4 cores, 7 gigabytes of RAM. And what I wanted to show is if I go and look into configure, you'll see the concept of the availability set that mm-hmm. we talked about before. So I have created this availability set called SQLHA. I have put my 3 virtual machines as part of that. And again, this ensures they're in different racks. Mm-hmm. And then I configure high availability between them. So to show this, I'm going to connect to the virtual machine, right? So again, this is the virtual machine that is running in the cloud. You can see the domain suffix at the top here, mm-hmm. right? cloudapp.net. And then I can see that I have my SQL Server here, right, installed by default. I can see everything exactly as I do on-premise. So I have my databases, my tables, everything there. Exactly the same interface as we have on-premise. So I can go and say, use this particular database, right? And then I can go and select from my table. And I know this is super simple, but basically what this is showing is all the skills that you have today for SQL Server apply 100% here.
So there's it's full nothing. Feature.
Full feature, feature, right? So you can see I have, you know, everything that you can look at in SQL Server, views, I have all the things in programmability, you know, full support for stored procedures, triggers, rules, etc. Mm-hmm. Even features like service broke, everything is accessible here.
Okay.
SQL 14, you know, things like in-memory databases, mm-hmm. you know, what we call Hackathon is available here as well.
Okay.
So everything is accessible here. Even high availability. So if we go here, for example, for people who want to guarantee that SQL Server is running at all times, right? Even if, for example, the virtual machine has to be restarted, they can go and configure availability groups, right? So you'll see here, for example, that I have an availability group that I have configured here, mm-hmm. right? And again, this is running between my two SQL servers in my virtual machines, right? So I have this one that I'm running as the primary, and I have the one running as the secondary. So what this will ensure is that even if the virtual machine goes down, the availability group will automatically fail over my SQL server, and this takes around 10 seconds.
Mm-hmm.
So that means that worst case scenario, I'll have 10 seconds of downtime, and I'll continue running.
Okay.
So people who are running production workloads that require high availability, they can go and do this as well.
Mm.
So very, very important capability. So basically what you have seen so far is highly available SQL Server configuration running on Windows Azure.
Right.
Right. Okay. So
maybe we can use the rest of the time to talk about some best practices that you see from customer deployment.
Yeah. Yeah. So let's actually do that. We have 7 minutes. Mm-hmm. Let's talk about you know, some of the best practices that we recommend to people to use when they run SQL Server in Windows Azure machines. So let's talk about high availability first. We just chose always on configure for these SQL servers. Again, the reasons why we recommend people is if you want to have failure detection for SQL Server, the failure detection that Windows Azure provides is at the virtual machine level.
Mm-hmm.
So it will detect if the virtual machine is not running, for example, but it won't see inside of the virtual machine. Obviously, for privacy reasons, we don't see inside. So if you want to detect failures because SQL Server, for example, is the service is down or it's running out of memory, you can configure a SQL Server high availability technology. Right. Again, the other reason is if your application can't stand the recovery times for restarting the virtual machine in a different host, which today takes around 12 minutes, then you can configure your high availability technology. Right? And it takes, again, 10 seconds.
Right.
Recommendations. So when you go and create these replicas, put them in the same affinity group. Again, this is a concept in Windows Azure. Right? When I provision, you can specify the affinity group. And this specifies to use the same cluster.
Mm-hmm.
Right? And you want these replicas in the same cluster to reduce latency between them.
Okay.
Same availability set. This ensures different mm-hmm. racks.
Mm-hmm.
And same VNet. Putting these virtual machines in the same VNet guarantees that they can connect to the name at all times. This is because the IP addresses of those virtual machines never change.
Right.
Right? So this avoids having to update DNS entries, for example, so you can always connect to the names. And finally, you can use these secondary replicas for something else than just waiting for a failover. You know, you can use it, for example, to move some of those read workloads. You can use them to backups. Something very powerful that you can do is you can actually load balance reads across these readable secondaries. So if you have some reporting applications, for example, that require very fast response time, and you have a very large number of users, you can, for example, add two replicas, right? And then you can have load balancer of the reads between them.
Okay.
This is basically what this picture is showing. So in your availability group, for example, in Windows Azure, you can have your primary and multiple secondaries. And then you can use these secondaries for failover, right? And your applications, your OLTP applications, will find the primary to something called the listener. A listener is just a DNS name,
mm-hmm.
right? And that's how they always connect to the primary. They don't need to find it. The listener will find it for the applications. And then you can have reporting applications, for example, connecting to your readable secondaries, right? Mm-hmm. And you can have a load balancer between them. So very powerful configurations that you can go and build today if you want. Let's talk about connectivity. Some of the best practices. So if you don't use some of the endpoints, you probably want to remove them. Again, this is just general security you know, best practice. Mm-hmm. If you're not using some ports, for example, just close them, right? And you can do that when you provision the machines through the portal. there is a capability called endpoint ACLing. So you can specify which are the IP addresses or subnets that can connect to specific endpoints. So you can control access to those endpoints. Obviously, don't disable Windows Firewall. You know, Windows Firewall is enabled by default. Don't disable. You can always open the specific ports that you need. If your clients are in Windows Azure, host them in the same virtual network as SQL Server. Again, this will ensure that the IP addresses never change.
Right.
They can always connect through the name. If you need Windows authentication to authenticate to SQL Server, you can either configure a domain controller, right, in Windows Azure, or you can set up a site-to-site tunnel between on-premise and the cloud and use your on-premise domain controller. If you don't use it, then you can simply use SQL authentication. Security best practices, we have Windows Update enabled by default, right? So we recommend not to disable it. That's how we ensure that all the security hotfixes are available on the guest OS. For critical SQL Server updates, people may want to turn on Microsoft Update. We recommend not using the account name administrator just because it's a well-known account. So people may want to use something else, right? By default, in the portal, this account is disabled, so you have to name it something else. We recommend people using a strong password, again. When you provision the virtual machine, the local administrator that you specify in the portal becomes the SQL sysadmin. That's the account that you can use to manage SQL Server. In some companies, they want to have the separation between the administrator of the virtual machine and the administrator of the SQL Server.
Right.
So if that's the case, you can go and change this. Right? And finally, for your clients, you can enable database connection encryption, and you can ensure an encrypted channel between your application and SQL Server.
Right.
Especially important if you're using public endpoints over the internet.
Right.
In terms of performance, I'm going to go quickly here. Actually, in the next session, we're going to go into detail in performance. So a couple of things. If your database fits in 1 terabyte, very easy, just create a single data drive, and you put it there. The data drive has a limit of 1 terabyte. You can have 16 drives, or 16 terabytes maximum. If your database doesn't fit in 1 terabyte, what you can do is you can stripe the data files across multiple disks. Similar to what you do it on-premise today. By striping, you also get larger IOPS limits, right? So there is a limit on the number of IOPS per disk, and that's 500. If you need more, then you can stripe again, and you get 500 per disk. Right? Use database compression, again, just to reduce the amount of IO that you do in the system. Use Windows Instant File Initialization. Again, this is enabled by default, and this is basically to reduce backup times. Right? Finally, something to consider is we have this storage system, which is separated from the virtual machines, and this is to ensure that we never lose data, and this is why we have 3 copies. But at the same time, that means that there's going to be some network latency between the virtual machines and the storage. And because of that, latencies may be higher than what you have, for example, with a local attached disk. So we're going to go into a little bit more detail in the next session about performance. We have a lot of resources available online. So the first place to go is the SQL Server in Windows Azure Virtual Machines documentation. So the link is in the screen. So from there, we provide all the best practices. We provide all the information about pricing, as well as some of the offers that we have, for example, with MSDN.
Awesome. Thank you, Luis. So everyone, thank you so much for watching this session. We're going to be taking a quick break, and we'll be starting in the top of the hour again. Thank you.
Thank you, Ramay. Thank you.